So we're going to review. One-sided significance test is what we started with. What was the significance test? Well, typically there's a claim somewhere. There's a claim that somebody thinks that this is true, and we think otherwise. Well, what we're going to do is test that person's claim using a sample. We sample a certain amount of people. We find a certain number of people that have done something. Then the key is we are going to be able to figure out if our sample proportion is far enough away from our claims proportion based on the standard deviation if the claim is true. So we're going to assume that the claim is true. We're going to find the standard deviation of a proportion if that is true of this many people. And then we'll be able to judge whether or not our sample proportion is far enough away. Now, if it's really far away, if our sample proportion is really far away from our claim, well, then our claim probably isn't true. But if our sample proportion is not far enough away, it's close enough where it is, you know, not super unlikely to occur, then we can't say that this isn't true, okay? This is how we would go about a problem like this. I would start with a null hypothesis, which is my claim. My claim is that my proportion of students that my friend thinks slept less than 7 hours was 80%. My alternative hypothesis is what I believe is true, or what I want to show. And in this case, I want to show that this proportion, since I think if the number is too low, I think this is going to be greater than. Okay? Now, the information I need to use is the information if my claim is true, my mu is 0.8, I would find what the standard deviation would be of data if this claim is true by using the formula for a standard deviation of a proportion, which is my p times 1 minus my p divided by my n. My sample size is 125. This would be the standard deviation if this claim is true. And I'd also need a sample proportion. So based on my sample, I found that 107 people out of 125 people slept less than 7 hours last night. Okay? And this is all that I'm going to type into my calculator, because what I'm going to do with all this stuff is find a standardized distance away from the mean that my sample proportion is, okay, which is our z-value. Our z-value is our most important value that we can calculate. If we don't calculate this correctly, nothing's going to be correct. And this is a standardized distance. Rather than comparing what my sample proportion is to my mean just by looking at it, I will be able to find, you know, a very standardized distance, which will be able to help me figure out how unlikely or likely this sample is to occur. So let's calculate all this. I have the square root of 0.8 times 1 minus 0.8. I can just go ahead and say that's 0.2. I know that. Divided by 125. If your calculator doesn't do the square root like this, I would do the 0.8 times 0.2, enter, divide by 125, enter, take the square root of that answer, enter. And I get this 0.035. Now, I'm not going to round until the end. I'm just going to include a dot, dot, dot here. What I will do is I'm going to store this value as x. Say if you aren't able to go up and select answers, you can store values as variables. So I store that as x. Now I'm going to find my sample proportion, the 107. No, if you have a newer calculator.
How do you do that? Store it as x.
You go STO, which is above on. And then you type x and press enter. My sample proportion is 0.856. Okay? So 85% of my sample did not slept less than 7 hours. Okay? 85%. Now that seems kind of close to 80%, but honestly, it doesn't make any difference how far it seems, because it's all about how far it is relative to the standard deviation, which is why we have a z score. Now remember, z-score is my sample proportion minus my claims, my population proportion, divided by my standard deviation. Now in this case, it is going to be the 0.856 minus 0.8 divided by 0.035. Dot, dot, dot. Okay, and I can do that in my calculator. I have the 0.856. I'll subtract the 0.8. In this case, either put this in parentheses and then divide it by my standard deviation or press enter, divide it by my standard deviation, which is still stored as x. I get 1.565. Now, again, this is important, this z-score.
If you thought it was wrong, you'd multiply it by 2. Nope, not yet.
We're talking about a one-sided, we'll talk about our p-value and whether or not we multiply it by 2. The z-value, we don't do anything to. You look at this and you can see whether or not this is far away from this. If we had a value that's in the 3s or the 4s or the high 2s, you know that's far away. Since that's far away, this is unlikely to occur. If this was true, you would say this can't be true. Right now you have a 1.586 or 565, you're unsure. Is it far enough away or not? It's not really easy to know, which is why, not far away to reject this. That's the key. We're not sure if this is far away enough to reject this claim. This is why we have a significance level and why we find a p-value, okay? The p-value will help us determine the probability that this event is going to occur. The p-value comes from our normal curve, and if I have a mu of 0, a z-score of 0, what is the likelihood that we would get something at least 1.565 standard deviations greater than the mean? So I find this area here. How do we find that area? We use normal CDF, which is under second distor. Distor is over vars. Normal CDF. Now, remember, if I want to find this tail, I would have to go from 1.565 up to what we say is a max of 10. Now, it doesn't have to be 10, but it's what we've been using. So I select this value, or if you needed to, since in your calculator, this will pop up as a table when you go second distor, you can store that z value as x. It changes your x. And then when you go second distor, normal CDF, you can type in x as your lower and 10 as your upper. And you get a p-value of 0.0587. Now, if we had a z-value that was negative, most likely we'll go to negative 10 to this negative z-value, okay, to find this area. So remember that. Now remember, the further that our z values are from 0, the smaller our p values. The further away, when we get into the 2s and the 3s, the less likely this is going to occur. Okay? Which is telling you that smaller p values will reject our claim. Smaller p values are going to reject claims. P values that are not that small mean that my claim could be true. In this case, this p-value is greater than my significance level. Now, I was told my significance level in the question, my significance level is 0.01. This is greater than 0.01, which is telling me that this 1.565 standard deviations away is not far enough away for me to say that this claim is not true. What I would do is say, fail to reject my claim. Claim may be true.
If you
forget
a
p-value
to a
significant value, yes. It has to be smaller than it to reject the claim. In this case, it is greater than it, which means I can't reject my claim. The claim may be true. Okay? All right. Let's do another one-sided. Now, notice, I did not take this p-value and multiply it by 2. I kept the p-value that my calculator gave me. That's because I have a one-sided significance test, which means I'm only finding this area up here. If this was a two-sided, which is when this is does not equal to, then I need to find the area here and add the area here to find the likelihood that we are, you know, that far away on either side. We don't have to do that for a one-sided. Let's do this problem. I'm going to change up the values a little bit. An LTH school board said that 50% of students went out of state this past week. You think that number is too high? You sample 200 students and find that 80 of them went out of state. Should we reject the blog's claim, use a significance level of 0.01? You guys do this, okay? All the way through from start to finish. Go. Compare your p-values to neighbors. Remember, do not round until the end. I don't think I can. All right, I got my values. Good. Make sure you have your final answer written down. Good. You ran it somewhere.
No.
You did. Guarantee you. I like the value. You're good to the third decimal place, but then this one is a little off. Yeah. Because you ran it somewhere. No, that's good. Just don't round until the end. That way you can get... I'm certain you must have. Good. Eight B. Oh, you sorted it as B?
Yeah.
Oh, here's your problem here. If you're gonna do this, you need this in parentheses.
And before I get the biggest.
Now, 0.8 is not my mean though. 0.5 is.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, that was.
There. Good. Good. Now make the correct decision whether the claim it could be true or must be false. Good. 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 That's wrong. That's off because you're rounding.
What did I round?
Don't round here.
Which one?
This. Instead of using 0.034, use this entire number. Okay? Good. Good. All right, ready? Here we go. My mean is 0.5. My alternative hypothesis that I think is that the number is too high. It's got to be less than. That's, make sure that's correct. Now, a lot of people don't even write that down because they can do it without it, but it's important to understand which way things should go. Claim, we got our standard deviation was 0.035 if this claim is true. My sample proportion is 0.4. We find that that's 0.4 is 2.82 standard deviations less than my claim based on the standard deviation, okay? Which is very far away, which is confirmed by this p-value, which is very small. Meaning that this is extremely unlikely to occur if this is true. So, since that p-value is less than that significance level, this z-value of negative 2.82, which was produced by the sample value of 0.4, is far enough away from 0.5 to say that the mean being 0.5 can't be true. Okay, I reject my null hypothesis. The claim can't be true. Okay? Most people got that right, which is good to see. Yes, Ms. Van. No. But it's important to understand why we say reject. We say reject because this value tells you that this value, which came from this, is far enough away from that, which means this can't be true. This has to be false. Whoever is writing this blog is just making stuff up. Get them fired from the blog. Okay? Now, the two-sided significance test, what's the difference between a one-sided and a two-sided? It comes from this question and the statement. In this one, we said that we thought that my friend's statement, my friend's claim was too low. So I said, no, that can't be wrong. It's on the low side. I said that my friend, I thought that the number was too high. So I think that, no, you're wrong, and it's on the high side. I think it's got to be lower. In a two-sided significance test, you just think that your friend is wrong. Okay, you're just being not nice. You're being mean. You're saying, sorry, I don't believe you. You don't care whether it's too high or too low. Your friend thinks that 70% of the students filled out a March Madness bracket. You say, no, you're wrong. Okay? Now, here's the difference. When we find our p-value, typically you guys have been finding the area in one of the tails. Not doing a great job. You've been finding like the area right here. Well, Since we are going to have an alternative hypothesis where we just don't think it's going to be equal to this, we need to find the probability that something is that far away, either on the high side or on the low side. So we need to find this area here to find my p-value, but then I'm going to have to also include this area on this side of things. How do I do that? I multiply my p-value by 2. So I'm going to find my p-value. Sure, that's the probability that something's going to be, you know, at most something or at least something, but then I will multiply that by 2 to find the probability that we will be outside of a value on the high side or the low side that is that far enough away. And this is what you're going to use, the 2 times your p-value. Okay? Go ahead and do this. I'll do it. We'll check our answers with neighbors, make sure everything is good to go. Yes. Yes. I messed everything up. Good catch, Ms. Martinez. Okay, we should have gotten a p-value of 0.029 multiplied by 2. I should have gotten 0.058 around, 0.058781. Bigger than 0.01. Now, some people, some test makers like myself, will put the significance level to be like 0.05. They will do this on purpose for your test or for your quizzes. And because once we get to the test, you're going to have to know if it's a one-sided or a two-sided. Let's put our phones away. This is important. Because if you don't know if it's a one-sided or a two-sided, if you don't know whether you multiply by two or not, you'll get two different answers. Because if I had 0.05, well, this is greater than my significance level, failed to reject. If this was a one-sided, though, and you looked at the 0.029, you would say, oh, this is less than the 0.05, we would reject my claim. So it's very, very important once we get to our test and once we get to our review and we start talking about making sure you understand if it's one-sided or two-sided, making sure you use the correct p-value and you make the correct decision based on your significance level. In this case, I would fail to reject my claim. My claim could be true. My sample is not far enough away from my claim to say that the claim has to be false, okay? Now, let's examples of what we've done so far. Let's move on to the next lesson. Let me give you your notes.